Yet it's more to come. We have with us here very soon, I hope. Let's see if somebody speaks to me in my ear here. They're nodding over there. Well, I'll do some talking before anyway. Kate shows us the importance of challenging set concepts and also perceived truths. And we'll, very soon we'll be coming back to the moon stage to check out how the pitches are doing. And it's also time for you, all of you watching online, to start and also to support the campaigns. But first, listen to Dr. Sweta Chakraborty. She's a risk and behavioral scientist, climate crisis communicator, there you are, Sweta, and media personality. And you join us via Zoom from Washington, D.C. Please give Sweta Chakraborty a warm hand.
Thank you, Katarina, so much for having me. Thank you to the platform for putting on this incredible event. We've had some great keynotes already today about communicating the climate crisis. Catherine and others have been notable in their efforts in this. I would like to take this time to contribute to this effort by sharing what I know about the brain and how having that knowledge has empowered me and can empower everyone tuning in and others around the world to speak with a firm and collective voice to various audiences. This is especially useful when communicating to the media and coming up against hostile personalities like I do so often. I will just share my presentation. Is that coming through?
Yes.
Great. We can get bogged down with the enormity of the challenges that are ahead of us. What gives me pause from fear and anxiety about the future is the knowledge that humans are innately solution-oriented. Just look at what we're all participating in right now. It's incredible how far we've come in a relatively short amount of time. Science and technology solutions hold a lot of promise for addressing the challenges ahead, and I support them across all fronts. But as a cognitive behavioral scientist, my contributions to the challenges described to help us is to help us overcome where our brains potentially hold us up in seeing through and supporting not just innovations and advances in science, but also what are the necessary behavioral shifts we will need to make to globally address the magnitude of what lies ahead of us. We need to start by talking about how our brain is wired and how our brains have been wired since the dawn of our species to react to the risks around us in a certain way. It's worked out great for us as we've evolved as a species. Our ancestors would see a snake and they would run. It's how we've evolved and it's how it's been helpful, but our brains haven't caught up with how quickly we've changed the environment that we live and operate in, primarily within the last 30 years since the Industrial Revolution. No brain, no speed of evolution can keep up with the speed of environmental change, how we as a species have impacted the environment around us. Research has found that we're irrational. We systematically depart from rational decision-making in a way that contradicts with traditional economic theory. We don't always make the best choices for our overall well-being. Rather, behavioral science research has cataloged decision-making shortcuts. These are more scientifically referred to as heuristics and biases, and include examples such as being influenced by subliminal number priming or finding patterns in randomness. These are all things that are not necessarily aligned to the truth, to the real statistics of various risks, but it's what we as humans can try from our cognitive limitations. We are also influenced by value-based factors, like how familiar something feels. We're more comfortable getting into a car than getting into a plane. Why? It's safer to get on a plane. Or whether or not we feel the risk in question is something natural or it's something that's man-made. We're much more scared of nuclear reactors than we are of volcanoes, for example. None of us are immune to these cognitive limitations, even those like me who study it. And the real-world implications are worrisome. We overestimate risks that aren't actually that serious, like getting vaccinated, eating non-organic foods, and we underestimate really serious risks, like our house and our community vulnerability to hurricanes and flooding. It's not gonna happen to us, is what we tell ourselves. We're programmed to be overconfident. We're programmed to ignore serious and slow-moving risks that are seemingly far away, like sea level rise is a good example. None of this is rational, but it's how we are wired. It's a human evolutionary trait that allows us to avoid cognitive dissonance. That's that uncomfortable feeling that we get when we have to process information that isn't pleasant, or it's even contradictory to the beliefs that we hold integral to our identity, that we hold to be true. It's part of our tribe. It's who we are. Many people attribute their stance on climate change to exactly this. If this was just restricted to individuals and to quirky brain functionings, that would be great. But there are real world implications here. Individual cognitive limitations, we think it's a personal problem, but those individual limitations can dictate policies that affect all of us. This doesn't just stay with the individual. Let's take an example of a real life pushback. Aquid Vantage salmon. It's a genetically engineered salmon that's able to grow to market size in half the time as conventional salmon. Salmon is the second most consumed seafood in the US alone. Since the 1990s, there has been a decline in wild Atlantic salmon populations. In addition to ocean warming, we've had overfishing and cross-contamination from farmed salmon. This has resulted in a spread of disease. So a 2001 World Wildlife Fund report has shown that the population of wild Atlantic salmon has fallen by nearly 75% between 1984 and 2001. These are stark numbers, and there's a growing population that's increasingly demanding animal-based protein. So it makes sense to advance research on something like this. Genetically modified salmon began its first transgenic creation in 1989, but it took 20 years plus to make it to market, to be approved, and then it was only allowed in the US market as of last month. So why is this the case? This is an example of science and technology, what science and technology innovations are up against, the type of public pushback that we can anticipate. And it comes from distrust stemming from the cognitive limitations of our brains. This is despite health and safety approval from regulators, and the fact that the fish is sustainable, for example. This one in particular is fast growing compared to wild and farm salmon. It's low cost. It uses less energy, less water, lower impact to the environment compared to traditional fish farming. It's reared in a controlled aquaculture system. So water use, recycling, sanitation, all of these things are carefully controlled. It's also despite the reduced use of fungicides, pesticides, antibiotics. These are also reared in land-based tanks, so it reduces the risk of escape. But even if there is escape, these genetically modified salmon are bred to be sterile, so they can't breed with wild populations. But yet there is very real public fear. And this is one example, but there's so many. This public fear is really critical to address. Inaccurate overreactions have real-world consequences. We have a rapidly warming ocean, and over half of the world's population is reliant on marine proteins, and we will need alternatives because the environment is rapidly changing. Without access to these technologies, despite regulators and scientists doing their job, we are, as a public, limiting science innovations and ultimately the tools we need in our toolkit to overcome a warming planet. We don't have the luxury of leaving innovations off the table, but if they aren't commercially viable because of public pushback, who is going to try? This is why behavioral science-based communication is so critical. The gold standard of communication is to understand the cognitive limitations of the end recipient. If we were rational and health and safety statistics were enough, we wouldn't be in a situation where innovations were being rejected. This is exactly what Catherine said. Information is not enough. This is why we still have climate change deniers. Knowing what biases, what mental limitations are at play, what values are being challenged of the different target demographics that we are trying to communicate to is crucial in being able to communicate effectively. We don't have time to get into the nitty-gritty right now of effective communication strategies because of the time limitations, but here's the minimum takeaway that I want to be understood. We need to know that people process information aligned to the limitations of the brain. Individuals and groups are prone to biases and have a variety of value-based factors that influence how communications are received and interpreted. So it is mandatory to do appropriate research and testing prior to communicating. Because this is what can happen if we don't do that. This type of communication, confusion. This is what we need to avoid. I assert it's better to not communicate at all than to communicate ineffectively. We want to avoid confusion. We want to support informed decision-making for behavioral outcomes that benefit individuals and society as a whole. We can't afford for people to overreact, to underreact, or to not react at all. The way to do this is to be compassionate, to be patient, to find those shared common values. What is it that those people care about? And then begin that conversation. Remember, people are experiencing cognitive dissonance when they're being confronted by contradictory information. Keeping that in mind, knowing that the brain has its limitations, being gentle will get us far in moving the needle forward towards climate progress. Thank you. I'll leave it there.